7. इमामबाड़े तक ले चलिए।
As we take a tanga at the Tilewali Masjid and ride out into the old city, this mammoth structure rises before us, unmistakable even though its gate is crowded by a countless canopies.
Our search for the seven wonders of UP begins right here in Lucknow, the capital city of Uttar Pradesh. Nawabi Tehzeeb compels me to bow down and introduce our first wonder. So say adab, with adab, to the Bada Imambada.
Built in 1784 by the Nawab of Awadh Asafuddaullah, the Bada Imambada is also called the Asafi Imambada.
The purpose of making these magnificent buildings was to generate employment. Historians say that when this project was undertaken, the estate of Awadh was reeling under a drought. Daytime used to be construction time. At night, these structures were raised to the ground to keep the cycle of employment in motion. The political opposition in the state says that the Nawabs of Awadh have a contemporary in UP Chief Minister Mayawati, but with a different sense of purpose.
The Chief Minister, they say, keeps building structures, raising them and rebuilding them, with none of the sense of purpose the Mughal rulers sought to create in times of hardship. The beauty of the Imambada belies that history of adversity, an intricately ornate Mughal design. It's uninfluenced by European influences that had become popular during those times. As you cross the periphery and enter the main area, the wondrous appeal strikes. This ancient well was built for the devotees to wash up before entering the mosques ahead. Asafi Mosque, the largest Shia place of worship in the city of Lucknow, in the hands of its architect, Kaifiyatullah, a fusion of Hindu and Islamic styles. The main Imambada is a huge vaulted central chamber containing the tomb of Asafuddaullah at 50 by 16 meters and over 15 meters high. With no beams supporting the ceiling, it's one of the largest arch constructions in the world. These tunnels, now blocked, were once escape routes for the royal family that led out to the banks of Gomti River, Faizabad, Allahabad and even Delhi. After people went missing trying to explore the hidden pathways, now old and crumbling, the government decided to block the entrances. But there are alternatives that remain for the lovers of mazes and puzzles. The labyrinth.
Enter the labyrinth at your own risk and make sure you know your way out.
As the sun sets, the scaffoldings too join in the play of light and shadow, efforts to restore the Imambada to its old grandeur that will perhaps make this memorable sunset even more perfect.
Now that you've seen the Bada Imambada, you must also see what leads to it. The reason why we treat it as a separate wonder is because of its sheer scale and size. Have a look.
The Rumi Darwaza, the name derived from Persian Rumi, that means Rome. The connection is roundabout, but joins an interesting thread of history. Ancient Constantinople, now Istanbul in modern Turkey, is a city shaped by the great ancient civilizations, Byzantine, Greek, and Roman. Rumi Darwaza is supposed to be identical in design to a gateway that stood in ancient Constantinople. It goes up to a staggering height of 60 feet. The uppermost part, a beautifully carved octagonal umbrella that you can climb. In the heydays of Awadh, the evenings here would be a magic we can only imagine. A giant lantern would be placed here on top to light up the surrounding. Little jets of water would rush out of the sides of the arc from carved flower buds, and the gate would stand tall in its glory, beckoning one and all.
Out of all the gates in India, be it the Gateway of India or the India Gate or even the Buland Darwaza of Fatehpur Sikri, Rumi Darwaza distinctly stands out. Vote for it and make it one of the seven wonders of UP.
From Uttar Pradesh, now we head towards the mountains of Uttarakhand. At these heights, nearly 7,000 meters above the sea, monuments and works of great architecture are few and far between. The biggest wonder is nature itself. We are walking towards one such area, the one and only Valley of Flowers. The trek begins at Gobind Ghat, after we cross a hanging bridge on Alaknanda River. From here, it's a 17-kilometer trek. While we cover on foot the distance in this difficult terrain, let us tell you about the history of the valley. A virgin land for centuries, it was introduced to the world as the Valley of Flowers by Frank S. Smith, a mountaineer, explorer, and a botanist in 1937. In 1982, it was given a national park status, home to some of the rarest of rare flora and fauna, across an area of 87 square kilometers. But as we inch closer, a riot of colors begins. Orchids, poppies, calendulas, marigolds, daisies, anemones blend together in a scenic carpet. Forests of alpine flora and rhododendron grow wild. These brush strokes of wilderness, heady even for the imagination of a poet or an artist.
You have to really travel for this place a lot, and it's worth taking so much of turmoil and stress to come here, because you can relax yourself. It's a beautiful place. It's nature. It's like heavens above and nature around you. It's the best place.
You know, I saw this place on the internet and I was really fascinated by this place.
But it's not so easy to travel into the valley. After being made a UNESCO World Heritage Site, entry has become restricted, not just for tourists, even for filmmakers. In case you manage to make the trip, this religious detour is a must. Hemkund Sahib, a pilgrimage in possibly the most pristine setting. The valley is open between May and October. Rest of the year it's cloaked in snow and cut off from civilization, a breather that it takes perhaps to prepare itself for the next season of splendor and beauty. Together they form a unique transition zone between the mountain ranges of Zanskar and Great Himalayas. The park is gigantic compared to the Valley of Flowers at 630 square kilometers. Otherwise, it is also a near virgin landscape, protected as a World Heritage Site. But we are here to visit not the park, but the twin peaks of Nanda Devi range that tower above it. It is a part of the Garhwal Himalaya, located between Rishi Ganga Valley on the west and the Gauri Ganga Valley on the east. Nanda Devi means bliss-giving goddess, a patron goddess of the region. The twins are the highest peak in India, strictly speaking, Kanchenjunga being on the border of India-Nepal, forever beckoning avid mountaineers and mountain lovers. When Tenzing Norgay, the Nepalese guide who with Edmund Hillary scaled the Everest, was asked what was the most difficult climb he ever did, he had surprised everyone with his answer. He had said it was the Nanda Devi climb from the eastern side. In these higher reaches of Garhwal also lies Kedarnath, one of the remotest of the Char Dhams. Char Dhams, the most important Hindu pilgrimage circuit in the Indian Himalayas. Gangotri, Yamunotri, Kedarnath and Badrinath. The journey starts from Gaurikund, which is important because it's connected by road from Rishikesh, Haridwar, Dehradun and other important hill stations of the Garhwal. From here, a 14-kilometer long trek along the Mandakini leads us to Kedarnath. According to legend, after the Kurukshetra war, the Pandavas, feeling guilty of so much bloodshed, sought Lord Shiva for redemption. Shiva eluded them and while escaping took refuge at Kedarnath in the form of a bull. On being followed, he dived into the ground, leaving his hump on the surface. Since then, it is a pilgrimage considered to be the permanent residence of Lord Shiva. The present temple built in 8th century by Adi Shankaracharya stands adjacent to the site of an earlier temple built by the Pandavas. The inner walls of the assembly hall are decorated with figures of various deities and the scenes of mythology. Outside the temple door, a large statue of the Nandi Bull stands guard. Built of extremely large, heavy and evenly cut grey slabs of stones, it is a wonder how these heavy slabs had been maneuvered in these mountains. This temple is open only between April and mid-November. The rest of the year, it's blocked by snowfall and extreme winters. In those months, these Shiva idols are shifted down to this temple in Gaurikund, where we had begun our trek. A two-day-long journey from Kedarnath and the other dham in these hills, and the most difficult, Badrinath. A town at 3,450 meters above sea level along the banks of Palangnanda River. It's nestled between Nar and the Narayana mountain ranges. It was called Badri Van in Puranic times because it was found carpeted by wild berries or Badri. The shrine is dedicated to Lord Vishnu, the preserver of all creation. The temple is approximately 50 feet tall with a small cupola on top. The roof is gilded in gold. The facade is built of stone with arched windows. A broad stairway leads up to a tall arched gateway, which is the main entrance. The architecture resembles a Buddhist vihara. The temple has undergone several major renovations because of age and damage by avalanche. It was renovated by Adi Shankaracharya in the 8th century. In the 17th century, it was expanded by the Garhwal kings. After significant damage in the 1803 earthquake, it was rebuilt by the king of Jaipur. The temple is visited by about 6 lakh pilgrims every year. The visit to Badrinath, in every sense, completes our journey. As they say, this is the ultimate stop, the last pilgrimage.